like your attitude, man. This is what you're doing.
Yeah, he got something going already. He's got something brewing.
Something cooked up. He gonna open his own Patreon and put the corn on his own.
Dboys.com.
That's right.
.org.
Click on that joint.
.org on
Listen here, y'all.
Don't try to walk away, then think about what you gonna say next time because you recording this AMA, Amaya.
Amaya.
Yeah, that trips me out every time.
I like your gum cocaine.
Beverage. Did he? What's that? Armor, yeah, I like those.
Yeah, I like.
Pretty tasty. I see you with the water, young Slimberling.
All day.
About to grab some booch after this.
You mean kombucha?
Mm-hmm.
You who?
Is that what you hipsters say now? Booch?
The booch.
I feel you. All right. Well, I can't hit on the youth.
I'll grab some booch and shoot the hooch. You know what I'm saying?
I don't know what you're saying.
I don't know either, but it sounds
perverse on the Chattahoochee.
Lord, I'm too old. I'm too
has
old.
Has your mom ever tried to make kombucha, D-Lo?
What's up?
Has your mom or anybody in your family ever tried to make kombucha?
No, I heard it's really hard.
I'm talking about that man's mom, man.
My wife asked that man if his mom tried to make kombucha.
Hey, man.
He's the person to do it, though.
He said something about this is your mom.
His mom is a talented cook in the areas.
I'm just saying, listen.
Is kombucha just like tea or something, though?
It's fermented tea.
Oh, okay.
So it helps with your digestion, man. It really has helped. That's like one thing, like, you know, like people talk about all this like stuff that'll help your digestion. That really will. Like, I've never had something affected that much.
Sure. With that being said, fellas, welcome to the corner. This show here is a safe space where we can come together and share our thoughts and feelings during this pandemic. We know it's not safe for us to meet together in person, but the tradition of real talk and honest conversation continues here on the corner. I am your host, Chris, and I am joined by my esteemed colleagues here on Influent Entertainment. We got the deep-voiced wonder, Barry White himself, DJ AMA in the building.
Deep-voiced.
Amazing.
Thought you about to say Slim. What's going on there?
You like it. You like it, though.
Hello.
Well, since he wanted to introduce you because it's his show, we got DJ Slim in the building.
What's happening, y'all? What's happening?
We also got the boy wonder, D-Lo, Daniel Lopez, in the house.
What up?
Guitar extraordinaire. And, of course, we have the anomaly, super producer, Mr. Io Cooley, in the building.
Is anomaly with 7 Z's or 4 S's?
No clue whatsoever.
Ah.
It sounds like you got the same education I got from the Atlanta Public School Education in New Jersey.
Congratulate me.
Now, if you enjoy viewing content like podcasts or music shows or all around good, clean content, holler at us. You can follow us on our YouTube page for clean content. You can also catch us on our Influent Patreon. That's going to be patreon.com/Influent ENT. That's NFLUENT. And let me do it again because Cooley hates when I spell it. It's at patreon.com/Influent ENT. That's NFLUENT. ENT. And if you're not already following us, follow us on Instagram at @influentENT. That's NFLUENT. How are we doing tonight, fellas?
This episode is rated W for Wild.
Are you about to say follow us on Instacart, dog?
Probably. Probably. Your boy is a lover of the Instacart, boy. I don't like being in them stores these days.
I feel you, man.
Man, I'm so today getting that cheap macaroni and cheese in the Burgundy John.
Really? You took from like the hot food bar?
No. You know the cheap John, the the Kroger brand macaroni and cheese.
Oh, like in like the refrigerator section?
No.
Oh, you mean like the blue box blue, but in the brown box?
That, see? Yeah, you know.
It is.
Gotcha. Okay.
That 10 for 10, baby. That 10 for 10.
Poor recognized poor, man.
Man, when I moved down here, I saw Kroger had 10 for 10. 10 for 10 what? I'll take all of them. Yeah.
For real, for real.
The struggle, man. It's no matter where you go, it's still constant. And that brings us into our next.
Wow.
It's everybody's show today. It's everybody's show. Good night.
Speaking of giraffes.
Go ahead, Keith.
Speaking of painful transitions. man, so tonight, you know, we're joking it up, but we're actually going to touch on a pretty serious subject to open up the show with, and we'll try to keep the rest of the show pretty light, but we just felt like it was important to address this subject because so many people are going through it right now. And that's just basically mental health during the pandemic, right? So we're right now in a situation in human history that's never been this way before, or not, at least not in our time, where people are shut in, people can't see friends or family, or they're losing friends or family to this disease, or can't be there for people in their time of need because the times are so serious. So it's important for everybody to have a routine in their daily life that kind of helps with getting through navigating this pandemic. So, you know, I open it up to you fellas. Number one, how has the pandemic affected your mental health? And number two, how have you been able to incorporate a routine to help you deal with or navigate these challenging times?
That's what's up.
Well, I'm from the Northeast, I'm from New Jersey, and that's, there's no pride in that statement necessarily, but it's a place of hustle. And when this all started, the one thing that people needed more of was cleaning. Like, they felt paranoid, and Chris can vibe with me on this because we're both in that industry. So if anything, I've learned that your industry, even in a place where, man, it's hard to say it that way. I don't want to seem smug, but it's like I've actually done better now than I was in normal stuff because people are so paranoid about keeping things clean. So I work more, you know what I'm saying? So it's kind of ironic, but I'm not, like I said, I'm not trying to stunt on it, like, you know, it's just I realize how important some things may be in certain situations. Like, maybe if this was another type of disaster, then I'd be, you know, I might be destitute. But in this particular part of history, I've been able to do more work more than normal, and so I have a different perspective than maybe someone who has lost their job for an industry that may not be, you know, so congruent to a disaster like this. So yeah,
I'm gonna piggyback.
Go ahead.
Cool. I was gonna say I'm gonna piggyback what you kind of saying. Like, I haven't. I guess the whole pandemic hasn't really affected my routine. In the fact that I never stopped working, you know, it's been the same routine for me and my wife. We didn't really miss a beat. If anything, I think work might have slowed down for her a little bit at the very beginning when everything was totally shut down. The background, she's in the medical field. I'm a firefighter, so it, you know, like I said, it, just because the pandemic broke out, you know, if anything, we picked up a little bit as far as call volume, people coming to her job. She deals with kids, so people dropping the kids off or any kind of sniffle they may have now, thinking it's coronavirus. So mental health for us has been, there hasn't been any, it's just kind of been consistent for us. I guess if anything, what's affected us is friends and family who are quarantining or have to be isolated, like my mom. She's been retired, but you know, with the pandemic going on, she's obviously not going anywhere, and that's, I can tell that is taking a toll on her being in the house all the time. So we try to call more frequently, but like I said, she's been tired of being in the house, you know. So yeah, it's definitely taking a toll on people. But for, like I said, for myself and our my immediate family, we've been, it's business as usual.
I think exercise has helped a lot with me, because I kind of started on getting more fit right before COVID, and like the year before COVID. So I think that's helped with my mental health a lot. I think starting the day off with something that you can get, basically just get out frustrations in the morning and just have the rest of the day go, when you're already, you know, in the zone. When you wake up kind of like in the zone to do something, the day goes by a lot better, I think.
Yeah, I think a lot of people picked up, you know, working out at the house, because, you know, like I said, the gyms and stuff were, all that stuff was shut down. But a lot of people have invested in home gyms and stuff like that. And when this whole thing broke out, because like my wife, same thing with her. She was a big gym rat prior to. So now that everything's jumped off, you know, we shut that down. So ain't no more going to the gym. But when she's trying to build up the home gym, couldn't find anything. There was nothing. The shelves were cleared out because everybody's buying up stuff.
Yeah. I think I have like a kind of unique vantage point about the pandemic. Like right before the pandemic, well, not right before, but a few months before the pandemic, my family decided to merge households so that we could help take care of some financial stuff on my mom's side of town. End up being a blessing though, because I end up being able to help out the congregation more on this side of town as well. So I have six people in my household, six people that are dealing with the pandemic in very different ways. I get to see it. So my mom and my sister were, you know, our regular pioneers. My wife is now as well. As of this week, but my mom and sister were regular pioneers, and they were used to going out in the ministry all day, every day. And now they and they're sitting in front of the Zoom screen all day, every day. And, you know, sometimes my mom just be wanting to go outside for no reason. Like, just, I ain't got nothing to do. I'm gonna create something for myself to do outside, or I need to run and put a check in the bank. You can mobile deposit. I need to run and put a check in the bank in the ATM, you know, just to go outside. Yeah. And my sister is the complete opposite. Like, she don't want to leave the house at all. Like, she could stay in the house in her room and not see nobody ever. And I think she's taken up like hobbies. Like, she's bought like pasta machines. So everybody getting fat over here because she just finding new recipes and cooking new stuff every other day.
Everybody's picking up new hobbies and stuff.
Yeah, right. And
that's mad provocative, kid.
Mad provocative. My wife started her company in the midst of a pandemic. She's a creative, so, and she's really good with graphic design. So she started her company in the midst of the pandemic, and that's kind of helped her to kind of channel her energy into positive things. And and also my son, he's really been the one that's been hit the hardest, because he's a kid, you know, and he used to getting together with other kids playing and stuff. And I myself personally, I mean, I'm kind of an introvert, so, you know, I've been okay during the pandemic. I've been doing better financially since the pandemic started. Just because, like Cooley said, we're in that field, we clean, so things have kind of picked up. But there's been a lot of like really kind of traumatic stuff that happened to my family during the pandemic. And I guess I kind of, you know, been praying and just kind of staying focused on, you know, on the positive that were going on in my life. But legit, the other day I just woke up and I just didn't feel good. You know, just was not feeling it, was not into the world around me, and just kind of all that stuff that I kind of been shoving to the side, all the negative stuff kind of started to catch up with me. Yeah, all in one day, you know. So, I mean, I think for the most part, I've been doing okay, because, you know, the one thing is we didn't stop the spiritual routine. The spiritual routine kept rolling. I picked up hobbies, you know, being creative, doing music again, doing podcasts and working on art with other people. And we just kind of, you know, kept the cycle rolling, you know, and that kind of helped us to deal with it. So let me pause for the cause for a second. You know, I have to do a special introduction here for the corner. Let me get close to my mic. So, you know, we just had a special guest to pull up into the building. You might see him on Saturday nights. Well, not see him, but hear him on Saturday nights on MixLR, because he has a fantastic show on Sure Radio called The Jukebox, where he takes regular requests. The GOAT this Tuesday night on Relevant Sounds went hard till 2 in the morning, rocking the sounds, had everybody on the radio bopping. We want to give it up to our guest star today on the show, DJ Sean Faze in the building.
Thank you. I do appreciate that introduction, but it was no need for it. But thank
it's
you.
Nah, it's too late. What you mean?
Hey, that's that Atlanta humble. I tell you right now, DJ MA, you got a competitor for deepest voice in the building right now.
Oh man, I'm doing all kinds of competitions already, huh?
Don't let them pit us against each other, brother. Don't let them put us against each other.
I hear you, brother. Nah, deep no voice, way.
Deep voices unite.
Good. That wasn't the same person all that time? Oh,
yeah. That are listening in, it could be the same person.
So, Faze, we were just kind of talking about the pandemic and just like the situation and how it could affect you mentally, but also how we're kind of coping, you know, in these circumstances. Everybody's kind of got different circumstances going on. I think you live alone, right? Right, Faze, or you got?
Yes, it's just me and my best friend.
Okay, gotcha.
That's my Dobie. That's my dog. So yeah, I basically live alone, but he's right underneath me, so he ain't trying to hear that.
Okay, gotcha.
Filling them blank.
So how's life in the pandemic affected you, my brother?
Oh man, I could tell when I came in here. You know, I came in right in the middle of it was like a somber environment. You know, you was going on. So, man, I think it affected me just as, you know, the same way that it affected the majority of us. You know, right now, just handling it the best way possible. You know, and I heard you saying that you were an introvert, and I'm introvert as well, brother. You know, I have no problem, you know, being by myself and staying in. One thing is that it's an adjustment. You know, it had been quite an adjustment, you know, with family, with the congregation, friends, you know. And a lot of us, either may have had it, or we know someone, you know, that may have passed from it, you know. So is all of us are infected, you know, whether it's directly or indirectly. It's just no way around it. You know, it's a pandemic. But I could say, you know, it's a good thing that we're in, you know, the right place. We in the perfect organization. We're imperfect people, but we could not be in a better organization than Jehovah's organization. Absolutely. And we got all the right answers. You know, we get instructions, and as long as we doing what we ask, we do the things, you know, that's passed down to us from the slave, you know, can't go wrong. And the thing is, it's just basically having to just encourage one another, doing, you know, having platforms like this and doing what we doing right now, man, it's, you know, it's brought so many of us together. You know, I'm meeting some of you all for the first time this evening. And it's good that we are still able to get out and congregate, man, and just, you know, we're able to uplift one another, because this is, it's no time like it, man. And it's so heartfelt when you could feel just totally strangers come together and vibe, you know. It's I already feel the love here, you know what I'm saying? So this has been, even though, you know, it's nothing like seeing our friends at the hall and, you know, being able to give them a hug, you know, this has been a gift for us, just being able to, you know, presume coming together and talking and seeing each other's faces on Zoom. Because, man, I'm telling you, we lost a couple of friends in our congregation, and and it does the friends wonders just being able to just congregate in this manner, you know, just seeing the face. It's a little different from talking on the phone. A phone call is good too, but just being able to see one another and see the smiles on the faces, you know, it does so much for us, man. I've now, when the COVID first started, I ended up catching it.
Oh, no.
I was like one of the first ones to get it. And it put me down for like 2 weeks.
Yeah. How was it? Like, I keep hearing, I've heard several people who've had it, and I'm getting different variations of their degree of how bad it was. Like, some people's like, oh, it wasn't that bad. I was out for a couple of weeks, but it was like more like a cold more than anything. And other people was like, man, I saw paradise. I saw the glimpse of paradise coming, you know what I mean? So,
you know, I'm sorry to cut you off.
No, you're
good. It's different. It's nothing like anything else. I guess the closest thing you could relate it to would be like the flu, because I had, you know, nonstop fever. You're just going on and on. I didn't have a cough, you know. I didn't lose my appetite. I still had an appetite, but I did lose my sense of smell and I lost my taste. And that was weird, because that never happened to me before. So I knew, you know, that I was dealing with something different. I did have one close call. It was kind of crazy. For the most part, I was good, but I did have I did experience a shortness of breath, and I've never had to deal with that before, so I didn't know what was happening.
Yeah.
But from my research, everything that I was looking at concerning COVID, I thought it was, you know, your lungs fill up with phlegm and you coughing and can't breathe, but it was nothing like that for what I experienced. It happened to me when I was asleep, and all of a sudden, I couldn't breathe.
Oh, no.
You know, it was, I was able to inhale and exhale, but I wasn't getting no oxygen. Like, I'm taking deep breaths, but it felt like I wasn't getting no air, you know?
Yeah.
And that was scary, but it only happened for a little while. And after that, I took my behind straight to the hospital, you know? But that was it, man. That was the only time, you know, something like that happened during that experience, so... You know, folks, you know, when we losing friends to it, man, and I'm hearing that they have to be on oxygen machines and all that, man, my heart goes out to them, because I know that's like one of the scariest things that you could ever experience.
You know, any residual effects from it? Do you feel any like residual effects from it?
You know what, man? I don't know if it's in my mind. You know, but sometimes I feel like I'll be having a shortness of breath. I get kind of antsy. I feel like, okay, let me think about, am I breathing well? You know, it's you know, and I feel like that happens sometimes, but it, you know, I guess I've just convinced myself that it might be just something in my mind from experiencing that, you know.
Do you think it also affected how you deal with other people? Like, just subconsciously, you know what I mean, after you've had it and you know that you can pass it on to other people, is that still something that kind of stays with you a little bit, in the sense of, well, I want to keep extra distance, you know what I mean, rather than just the usual?
Well, when I ended up coming down with it, even before then, I was like extra careful. I was wearing the latex gloves. I had on the N95 mask. I wasn't wearing nothing but that, had the extra filter on the inside. Mm-hmm. I felt like I was doing everything I could. Hand sanitizer, washing my hands.
Did you do the the little hold your breath thing. Y'all heard of that? Like, hold your breath for 10 seconds.
Yeah, I heard about it. And that's one of the things. I did that, but that doesn't mean nothing. I was trying to see if it you know, if that's something that affected me when I came down with it. But I was able to hold my breath, and, you know, and nothing happened. Like I said, it was something, it was just a shortness of breath that I had all of a sudden. Just like, because I was able, I felt like I could take a nice deep breath. But it still, it felt like, let me say, like having a bag over your head. And there was no oxygen in the air. And that's what I experienced. And, you know, and I guess it makes you look at life different. It tells you just how, you know, how sensitive, you know, life is, man. Fragile. You know, because I was like, if I can't get my air back, I might be out of here. Just like that, you know. And that's one of the things, just like that, you lose your breath and you can't breathe, man. It won't be long, you know.
Did you have a pre-existing, like, do you have asthma or any breathing type of thing going on?
No, I didn't have nothing pre-existing. Nothing that I know of. I never had asthma, never had issues breathing. Yeah. And that's the crazy thing with it, you know. I felt like I was 100% healthy. But I know one of my siblings came down with it. They got through it pretty quick, you know, and I think that's where I ended up getting it. Not to place the blame on nobody, but that's the only, I was just around my
heart. Hey, the only way you can get it is from somebody else. That's how it works. That's how it works. Right.
But I was playing with my nieces, and I think that's how I ended up getting it. That's the only time that I actually did not have a mask on.
Blame the babies. Go ahead, blame
the
babies.
Gotta put a cross on the children.
Do it right on their forehead. Bow.
The reason I believe it was from my niece, because my sister called me the day after I was over her house and told me, she like, yes, she just got a call from one of the teachers and said it was somebody in her class that, you know, tested positive. I was like, oh man, you know
it's crazy. It wasn't,
and she
it wasn't even
right
a,
in your face.
It wasn't even the baby. It was the phone call that did it. Them letting you know.
It probably so, was.
Cause the signals started coming down.
She sneezed right in your face, dog. She sneezed right in your face. You remember?
No, it wasn't a sneeze, but you know, she was about five. I think she was maybe about four at that time. And she's the most precious little thing in the world. And she,
except for that,
you know, she barely get her words out. So she was talking with like a slight lisp. So, you know, a couple of times she might spray me when she say something.
Oh!
No, but I didn't think that much about it.
Come on,
that's the deadly.
Bro.
That's the deadly particles right there.
Now, did you lose taste and smell?
Yeah, I did.
Yo, that is freaky. When you lose taste and smell, you lose it when I lost it when I was eating. Like, I was cooking something, and then when I started to eat it, I lost taste and smell. I'm like, this ain't cool. Like, my mind can't accept that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was really weird when I got it.
You know what would have been messed up? If you thought you ain't seasoned the greens enough, and you just like,
yeah, because I am half Caucasian.
Let me put some more seasoning in these greens. Put some more seasoning in these greens. But man, we appreciate, man. I'm glad that everybody's doing good here. You know, our hearts go out to all the friends that haven't been doing well in the pandemic, and you know, we're going to keep praying for each and every one of you. We're a brotherhood, we're a worldwide brotherhood, and we're here for each and every one of you, and we love you very much. But man, we're going to get away from the somberness real quick. We're going to let DJ AMA tune y'all up a little bit, and then we'll be back with another lighter topic.
Let a tear drop.
Hey, some Waka Flocka or something, man. Come on.
Not the Flocka. AMA, did you mute yourself? You fired. You share your computer sound?
Play this whole segment out. like a whole thing.
Oh, we got to fire AMA, man.
I don't want no music or nothing covering.
We ain't got no severance packages here on the corner.
Live.
Just fire.
I thought that was something for a second. It was the music in my head. My fault. Like, get it.
Fine. Get it all in. We're going to edit all that out.
Hey, who editing it? It's me.
Well, you didn't even share the computer. That's what's up. He ain't even turned the computer on.
Chuck, I thought I spotlighted you. Why can't we see Slim?
Hey, man. Get him a man.
What up, y'all? Yeah, soundtrack, what's poppin', baby? If y'all ain't know, I go by the name of Lupe Fiasco. Representing that first and 15. Yeah, and this one right here, I dedicate this one right here to all my homies out there grinding. You know what I'm saying? Legally and you know what I'm talking about? So, check it out. First got it when he was six, didn't know any tricks. Matter of fact, first time he got on it, he slipped, landed on his hip and busted his lip. For a week he had to talk with a list like this. Now we can end the story right here, but shorty didn't quit, it was something in the air. Yeah.
Y'all wanna floss with us, cause all across the board we burning up. Drop a little paper, baby, toss it up. You slacking on your pimping, turn it up. See the money in the thing.
Cake thick, I live the life. Eating crab, watching shake it all night. I make the big moves, do the big thing. Take small groups, turn them into big names. The big dog with the big change. Frostbit bracelet, the magic cat say I'm the man. Type of that you need in your crew, type of dude that'll do what you won't do, can't do, get more burned than a candle, too hot to hold, too much to handle, in the black seat low, you know, if she look, she go, bye-bye with Dada, and I ain't gotta say no more, I'm the truth like AI, got the proof and stay fly, in the safest you could never buy, know why, cause I write the songs that the whole world sing, I don't know about y'all, but every night I swing, the Ferrari or Jaguar, switching four lanes with the top down, screaming out, money ain't a thing, dang.
Baby, this is your typical, everyday, one night thing. It's a physical, I'ma love you tonight, gang. Love calling your name, go jump on in the range and roll over. I just really wanted to hold you, it's time to get to know you. That's a good chick, before it's all over, I'ma meet this chick. Probably treat this chick more better, cause if you ain't, no, thugs and ladies go together. Popping my collar, partner, who in the spot? Baby, ruling the spot, in the mug, in the watch. Half of y'all hate me, half y'all love me. The ones that hate me only hate me cause they don't trust me. And they say I'm lucky. You think I got time to blow all this dough and do all these shows? On flight in the llama charging white for the old another episode.
Do I do?
To everybody that be living it up, we say.
What I do?
And all my ladies that be giving it up,
what you do?
To everybody that be living it up, we say.
What do I do?
And all my ladies that be giving it up.
Movies all around, but you look like the feature. Had another meeting, and my plan is to meet ya. Got my hands out, all I wanna do is reach ya. All I wanna do is greet ya. Infatuated, sorry if I stare. When you're posted up, I wanna be there. When you're curved up, it just ain't fair. No, it ain't. Try to bite my tongue, but I can't take it. I got whiplash from your turn in my head. Somewhere else to go, no, I can't make it. I'd rather take my chance with you instead. Do you second that emotion?
AMA, man, we be waiting on the mix, but when the mix come through, when the mix come through, though.
You flipped that, didn't you? put your foot all up in it.
Okay. That was killer right there. That was killer.
The mix, get in your the bag. Mix come through, sir. It come through.
I like
get
it.
Get in your bag.
Appreciate it.
So living it up.
So this the ladies be living it up though, man. I remember when that joint came out, bro. That was the most interesting blend of voices, you know, the super smooth singing with Ja Rule's extra I smoke 10 packs a day voice.
Right.
It was the most interesting sound. But man, this segment here is for the DJs, really, man. And I'm pretty sure being the fact that our producers have played in live bands before, they've experienced something very similar. But you know, you're a DJ, you're an artist, you get paid to craft your art. AMA, that mix he did, and he put in work on that. He made sure that he assembled that mix so that it was for your listening pleasure. Now, when you get paid for an event and you're going into an event to show off your skills, there's always that one or two or 10 or 12 or 25 people that want you to play they song. So DJs, how does that affect the work environment when we getting all these requests? And we thought about this topic because DJ Sean Faze has said on Saturday, all he does is take requests for that set. But how do we feel?
How Christian of you, sir.
Yeah, really. It's a public service. But how do we feel about a bunch of requests at a gig that you're getting paid for? Fellas?
It depends, man. It's not ideal, especially when you got your set ready to go, you know. The stuff that I've done is typically weddings. I normally do weddings. So the bride and groom have their songs that they want to hear, their songs they don't want to hear. So when somebody comes up, oh, can you play such and such and such? And you just like, yeah, no, I cannot. But a good diversion too is I'll kick it to the bride and groom. I'll be like, yeah, you go ask them. If they come over here and say they want to hear whatever, then I might put something on for them. And but it is annoying once you got the set already going.
I definitely concur. As we've made mention before, DJing is a craft, it's creativity, you're being able to flow with certain songs. It's a method to the madness, so to speak. And when somebody kind of jumps in and throws something in there, that's throwing a wrench into that whole plan, you know what I mean? Like, McDonald's has the people that are flipping your burgers away from you for a reason, so that you don't put your own spin on it, you know what I mean? And so, with that being the case,
did you just compare the art of DJing to making a sandwich at McDonald's?
Well,
can I get extra pickles?
Let me clarify.
And some onions and special sauce.
Yeah, let me
on my Whopper.
Let me clarify.
Hey, Whopper? Hold on.
Let me clarify. In the art of being able to craft what sounds appealing to everyone else, you know what I mean? That's the analogy that I was placing there. And the understanding that it's more than just you, but you hear what you want to hear. Ooh, play that song for me. Where it's like, hold on, man. Like, I'm doing a whole bunch of other stuff for a lot of other people besides just you. So if I have to cut out a portion of my time just to satisfy your desire, it may not even be something that you really like. Oh, you played that one? You ain't got the other version?
Right.
Like, it just don't stop from there. You know what I mean? So, and I understand that because I was actually guilty of doing that. I have one of our esteemed colleagues did some work for me. And before he did some work for me, I actually came up to him multiple times and was like, yo, play that. And he kind of gave me that look like, yeah, okay.
I'm guessing that was Faze. I'm guessing that was Faze. Faze's face was like, yeah, I remember you.
So I'd like to give a public apology to my boy Faze. My bad. I understand. You know what I mean? I get it. I get it.
Don't accept. Do not accept.
You gave me that understanding.
Hey, crying hard.
And I learned it now.
I'm going to accept it for this reason. Because if you a DJ, I've been DJing long enough right now to know that comes with the territory. if you doing, I mean, I don't think it's been any gathering and anything that DJ, if the DJ is accessible, people are going to walk up to you and ask you, do you got this? Do you got that? Can you play this? Can you play that? And, you know, it's just, you can't get upset. You know, it comes with the territory. You come to expect it, you know, when those requests start coming in. And my thing is, sometimes it's frustrating. I might say if it's a wedding, you know, normally when you got, when you're doing a wedding, it's a specific playlist you go by. You know, the bride and groom or the coordinator is going to give you that playlist and you want to stick to that. And I always be like, look, I got specific instructions. So if you want anything played, that's who I'm answering to. So you need to go to them and let them come to me if you want to hear that song. Now, if I'm doing anything, now I haven't done this yet, but I was trying to think of ways I could make the request situation work. And one of the things I thought about doing, and it's been a while since we haven't been able to get out and do any gatherings, but I was going to set up a request jar, a tip request jar. Someone come, I'm going to just write, you know, put request on it, had a jar in there, might throw a couple of dollars in there.
There it is.
Somebody want a request, make a request, I'm going to point to that jar. They say, hey, it's not guaranteed you drop something in there, I'm going to play your request, but you got a lot better chance, you know. Yeah. And that's how I go down, because, we're working. You know, when we DJ these events, you know, somebody's paying us to be there. We got all our stuff that we setting up, and they may be paying us, you know, to play whatever songs, whatever type songs. So I'm not there for you. You a guest here, you know. And if I do play your request, you know, it's just, it may be something that I had already had set up to play. Or I might, you know, normally, you know, if it's that type of a gathering where it's just, you know, anything, they just open to any music. They say, do you? If I'm in the mood, yeah, I might play some requests. But the thing about doing that is, you know, once you play the first person request, you know, open up a can of worms. Mm-hmm. Everybody's going to come to the, oh, he's taking requests. You got that line coming, and you don't want that to happen. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, if you do it, you got to be discreet about it or set up that request job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I start taking requests, it's going to be like toward the end of the night, wrapping up. They already done did their little exit thing or whatever, and it's pretty much the requests are starting to come from the friends and stuff that are helping clean up.
Absolutely.
Oh, can you play such and such? Yeah, I got you. Because in the midst of me playing that, I'm cleaning up too. You know what I mean? So now it's just kind of freestyling, so to speak.
And that's also what I would feel like is kind of leaving your own little business card, so to speak, for those people that tend to stay around a little bit longer and you are able to put in their request or whatever, that then gives them a platform to be like, hey, we did have that fly DJ where he did the set and then he did my request. So that may linger a little bit longer as well. I don't know if that's ever happened to you, Faison.
It happened with you, Slim. You the one making all the requests. And you're like, yeah, I'm about to call Faze for my wedding.
Did I play your request? when you made those requests, did I not play them? When you made those requests, because I don't remember, but since weren't you it was your wedding, right?
Well,
is that when what you're I was talking about, or you're talking about something else?
When I was making the request, it wasn't my wedding.
Okay.
That was a separate thing. But when, like I said, when you were doing my wedding, I didn't put in any requests because, like I said, I trusted you to handle your thing.
Right.
You know what I do hate, though, during weddings and stuff, is when people put a request in on a song that's coming. You know what I mean? Oh, can you play such and such and such? And, like, obviously, it's a popular song at the time, so you know it's coming. You know what I mean? That's what everybody want to hear. But they trying to... They'll come up and ask, oh, yeah, I'll tell them, yeah, it's coming. Probably not even a song later. Hey, when are you going to play such and such? Okay, look, now I'm going to step away from the booth. Told you the song is coming.
Sat down.
Yo, when they make them requests.
Have several seats.
when they make the request that's already on my playlist, I just let them have it. I'll be like, all right, that's what you want. I got you.
Yep.
That's
yep.
all I say. I got you.
Yeah,
right. I got you.
You know, let them have it. Let them feel good. They feel like, it's, you know, he playing the song because of me.
Dion?
Hey.
Do y'all know where the requests came from? the idea of requesting a song came?
Oh, I didn't know there was.
I didn't know there was a history. Drop it.
Yeah,
on
it's me. From live bands.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I got a birthday party. Let me hear happy birthday. Or let me hear this song that my wife, it's our anniversary, blah, blah, blah. Mm. So I know this is for the DJs. But let me just say.
Oh, no, shine me, please, my brother.
Well, you said it's for the DJs. But as a live musician, I will say it's just as frustrating as a live musician. For you to be killing, you're a murderer. Like the venue, whatever, the people that have hired you have told you what vibe they want and everything. And then someone comes up and they're like, yeah, I want to hear some Engelbert Humperdinck or something. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like some craziness that you don't even know. And you gotta see, that's where, if you remember, like, I think it was episode 2 or 3 when we talked about DJs and musicians, mm-hmm. and how people will draw that line. That line is getting thicker and thicker because with this conversation here, somebody will come up and ask you to ruin the vibe that you're building for their party. Like you're actually literally making their thing successful. And they'll ask you to play like some sad Brian McKnight joint when he broke up with his wife and he was trying to get her back. Right. You know, I forget that joint. Do you ever cross my mind? So, anytime.
Yeah. Anytime.
And you busy doing chic or, yeah, you killing. You're our you know where this night is going if you just let me do my job. Mm-hmm. But in answer to your question, Faze, yo, this is my favorite way to take care of requests. If you have requests, write them on the back of a $50 bill, and I'll get back to you.
Nice.
Word up.
I say that all the time at gigs. If you have any requests, you know what I'm saying? If you're unaffiliated, write them on the back of a $50 bill. We'll get back to you.
Like it.
Might not even do it, but write on the back of $50.
Right on back of $50. I'm a player.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, somebody write the thing on the
next request.
Yeah. Yeah, man, somebody write that thing on the back of a $50 bill. You gotta be a breakout. Les freak. Say chic. Do you ever cross your mind? Right into it.
right into it. Straight up. And as a band, you could just play all that stuff. Like, yeah, what else you wanna hear for 50?
For sure,
you got
for
it.
Sure.
So yeah, if you ever wanna hear, if you gotta hit them with the 20, because you know, they are peoples. Yeah, just write on the back of a 20 and we'll get back to you.
Don't even promise. 50.
I like that 50. I like that energy.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Keep that same energy.
Yeah, because they don't know. Now, let's break it down for the friends that don't know.
Get them.
Those speakers that they're hearing that joint pump out of, that the older friends are kind of complaining about. Yeah, them joints, they all cost money. They cost money. The fact that you're effective as a DJ is time that costs money. If they were at their job, their secular occupation, they would quantize it as money. Mm-hmm. So don't be surprised when we say, you want to hear that? Cool. And Faze hold up that jar like.
Yeah, exactly.
Come on.
That's a great illustration, though, Cooley. It's like walking into somebody's job and being like, hey, how would you like to do additional work and not get any more money for it? Like your job description.
Because
now,
you're here. You're here.
Your job description now entails you doing more work for my benefit.
Yeah.
And I'm not paying you.
Now you get the analogy.
I hate bright ideas.
Don't try to double back on that analogy. Your analogy was terrible.
When
you're crafting a sandwich, it's just like needs to get out of here.
Come on, mustard.
I see you trying
to mayonnaise.
You at the job. You at the job.
Don't try to clean it up. Like, you trying to sweep. You trying to sweep it up. Don't try to sweep it up, Slim.
See what you're doing?
Tell them to write your request on the back of a 50.
Did anybody else get the McDonald's?
They did.
Did anybody else get it? Everybody else got it but me? Nobody. Nope.
I felt where he was coming from.
You're a vegan, you hear McDonald's a little different.
Catch that elbow.
I don't eat McDonald's.
Put yourself on mute. You didn't get it.
You don't even eat McDonald's.
Nah, yeah. He's straight vegan. He's talking about McDonald's.
Faze's body is a temple.
That vegan
McDonald's.
But yeah, just write it on the back of a 50 and I'll get back to you. Don't even promise them you're gonna do it. Just I'm gonna get back to you.
And let me ask you this. As a live musician, I would think it'd take a little bit more to play a request. Because don't y'all have to, like, prepare certain songs? I know, you know, y'all probably get on a certain key and just vibe, but I mean...
Yeah, but if the bass player don't know it, or the drummer don't know, we have to fake. So, it's literally... So, Faze, we had... I think it was our second or third show where we talked about, I've always been a live musician. I've DJed too in the past, whatever, but the vibe of what a live musician and a DJ goes through, people try to split a line like, nah, you don't know what you're doing because you can't play. They're quantizing into physical skill. But what I'm saying is the momentum that you give to a party as a DJ is the same exact way that we approach gigs. You see what I'm saying? So that's the thing. Like, and you're right. It's because it's multi-instrumental. You kind of need to be on the same wavelength. But, and it is harder. But, like, that's why we don't take requests. We'll brush you off quick. You know what I'm saying? Because
security.
I can't ask five people if they know the song and the singer. Does the singer know the song? I don't even know.
You might have to change the key for the singer too.
Yeah,
it's a male or female. You might ask for a female song from a male, and it's like they don't know though. See, that's why I'd say it's the same thing, because the audience is the same way. They don't know what you have to do to get to that point.
Exactly. Right.
You know, well, we all have to deal with it the same way though. Like, musicians and DJs have to deal with the same. You want to hear slow jams because your wife want to dance slow? There's 300 people here. That's two of y'all that want to dance slow, and 300 people that want to get it in for the next 30 minutes.
I was going to say, too, like, I have, like, a kind of unique thing about, I get what you guys are saying about requests, because being, like, a music teacher, you want to teach, I mean, every kid is, like, different. You teach every kid different. Everything happens for a certain reason with some kids, but then you'll have the parents that request you to teach a certain way, and they don't know what they're talking about, and they tell them, oh, well, they need to learn this first. I was like, well, they can't even hit a couple notes in a row, so I don't think that's gonna happen. So
They know better than you what to do. Yeah,
right.
DJs especially know that.
Yeah.
I never thought about asking, I've had been around plenty of bands, but I never thought about asking for a request unless I was hiring that band and I was like, yo, you got to play this. Okay, y'all play this and play that. I never thought about, but I appreciate them jewels you dropping. I didn't know that's where it started. I thought requests always, I thought it started from like the disc jockeys, the radio DJs, the request line. Yeah. You know, but
it's like the juke joints back in the day, you know what I'm saying? Like all that stuff back in the day, like it would be like, yo, y'all know some Duke Ellington or whatever. And I'm just spitballing, but what I'm saying is I deal with that at every gig. Mm-hmm. And it could be a focused, like we're playing this gig for this reason for these people. There will still be 30 people that come up, yo, this is my anniversary, or yo, this is my thing. Can you do this? And I have to check with five different other people to see if they know it. Now, you're right what you're talking about, but I don't want to detract from the idea that you have to deal with the requests literally the same way I do. Like, because your vibe that you're building, DJs actually build a vibe just like a musician, just like a band does. You know what I'm saying? Like, we build a vibe to get the crowd to do literally what we want them to do.
Right.
We want them to party cool.
Have y'all ever had a request? See how to work. So like, have you ever played a song, right? And so I'll give you the example. I did a wedding and the bride, I guess her family or something like polka music. So there was a specific polka song that they wanted to hear. They said, can you find such and such? I said, okay. Did my research, found it. I was like, all right, played it for them. Tell me why the family thought that was opened up the floodgates.
The vibe for that, all these,
all these random, like, just, I'm like, no, I don't have any.
You know, Heisen Schnitzel.
Yeah. You said one Heisen Schnitzel is enough, and you should know that.
Right.
I'm like, the thing is, he, all right, so say they requested something, like, literally, I know a polka song from a polka band I was in Jersey. Mm-hmm. In heaven, there's no beer. That's why we drink it here. Like, that's the name of it. Anyway, my point is, if he plays something accurate enough for the genre, they're gonna be like, oh, he knows this whole genre. Like,
right.
If you were to go, if you flip your, I don't want to say race, but like, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you were a Polish person who did a Polish wedding, and then a black person came up to you and said, could you play some Marvin Gaye? You know what I'm saying? And then they said, nah, play all the Stevie Wonder. And you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what you're talking about. Like, they just ask you to change genres all of a sudden.
Right. With those requests, man, you gotta fake it as best you can. Like, if you can get some type of chord progression going with the rest of the people, you're like, hey, this is what we're rolling with. The the riffs might not be exact, but you're like, hey, we're just gonna
let it ride.
People are demanding, dog, especially from DJs, dog, especially for DJs.
You're right. I'm the type, man. I just feed off the crowd. You know, whatever, you know, and you could. I guess as the night goes on, you know, you tend to pick up on the type of music that they feeling. And sometimes, yeah, you could get that request. If you go ahead and play that request, and then all of a sudden you had the floor packed all night, and then all of a sudden everybody dispersed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like you said, that'd kill the vibe.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Right.
The worst people in the world. Now, God bless them, but the worst people in the world are wedding planners when they've never planned a wedding before. And they come up to you and tell you, I need you to play this, and you lose your crowd. You lose everybody because of the vibe that they switched. They vibe switched you, and you weren't, you're like, yo, I can't do this. And I know y'all DJs know exactly what I'm talking about.
Sure. Yo, we can get into that wedding planner hate in the bonus episode. And, DJ AMA, I hate you for asking a question that took us over time, knowing that we ain't got that much time. Joker, start your set so we can get to the last topic. Can't stand you.
At least you didn't tell the people what we're doing, so good job.
Right. Y'all tune in. Check out DJ Slim.
When I hit the dance floor, you know I'm doing a stanky leg. South submarine gang, then you rub across your head. If you're an ace boom chick, you can do it too. Snap your fingers in the air and shake your microphone too. Now you can lean with it, and you can drop with it. You can switch to the other leg, and you can stop with it. Now
but you ain't got no clue about what a real like me do. I like to stack my bread and flip my chips, and I can change your life if you get with flip. I take private jets to Vegas, man. It's 20 grand each bet, cause I'm major, man. We can cruise the world in a Bentley Azure, but don't worry, the chauffeur opened the door. You couldn't ask for more, cause we got it out. Cause you my baby girl, right? Right?
Sunshine, I could call you my baby boy. You could call me your baby girl. Maybe we could spend some time. I could be your sunshine. I could call you my baby boy. You could call me your baby girl. Maybe we could spend some time. I could be your sunshine.
everybody right here. What you need to do is be thankful for the life you got, you know what I'm saying? Stop looking at what you ain't got. Start being thankful for what you do got. Let's get it to him, baby girl. Hey.
And understand this is who
I am. Upset, I completely concur. Life could be such a blur. Obviously, we prefer our privacy, but instead we endure. Yes, sir. Don't expect nothing less of me. Cause it's gonna probably be this way until the death of me. But for the hustle and the lady on my arm now. Plus all my kids and my moms, I'ma calm down. And yeah, we doing just fine. It's the time just fine. Live one headline at a time.
My life, your entertainment.
Slim, you fired. Hate you so much. Goodness. Good night. You tell you make somebody co-host in a Zoom meeting, they just take all the liberties. All the liberties.
Excuse me, he was on some hits right there. I know you
doing that musical.
I know you felt the earth.
Oh, hate your guts. Hate your guts. Everybody, welcome back to the corner. This is we're gonna introduce a new segment right now. Segment is Does It Hold Up? Now, this segment is in reference to movies that we used to watch in the past. And at the time of us seeing this movie for the first time, it was the best movie of all time. But sometimes you might double back and watch this movie and realize it don't quite hold up. So this past week in a bonus episode, if you are on the Influent Patreon, you caught that bonus episode. We were tasked with watching the original Batman in 1989, starring what's his name? Michael Keaton.
Michael Keaton.
Directed by the Dark Dude. That was his name is.
Nice.
Yeah, whatever his name is. Anyway, at my first time seeing this movie, it was the greatest movie on the planet. But rewatching this movie within the last few days had some debates on that. So I throw it out to the group. What did y'all like? What did y'all dislike about the movie? And did it hold up?
I'ma start it off. Of course, like always. No, I'm just kidding. But I just wanted to start it off and identify some of the things that maybe we don't really appreciate about some of the older movies that we had back in the day. Batman was, it was groundbreaking. There was nothing like it. Cooley made mention earlier about this. He was talking about how this movie literally set the way for a lot of other movies to be made. It was really, really great, greatly done. One of the things that I really enjoyed was the music. The music was on point.
Yeah.
The music was a plus. It was done by not only Danny Elfman, but also Prince as well. Prince had a couple features in there. Mm-hmm. Definitely fire. The introduction, where it just seems like you're just going all over the place for no reason. And you just like, what are we doing? You know what I mean? We're zooping past, only for it to then give you the faraway view of the bat symbol. Like, that was pretty epic. You thought it was had something to do with the movie, but it was honestly the introduction. And like I said, that was where it started to go downhill from then.
We double back real quick. Should we know who Danny Elfman is? I don't know who. Should we know who this is?
Do the producers know who Danny Elfman is?
Probably not.
Okay.
I don't know. What y'all, I go to y'all for the hard hitting musical questions. Y'all don't know him, he ain't nobody.
Yeah. If you don't know what that means, because you've never watched Batman before, that literally did not exist before this movie.
Yeah. Okay.
But you know what it is now, though.
Right.
All of us, you know, it's a superhero thing or something. That's because of Danny Elfman.
Yeah.
See, that's why you got to ask the questions, man. Just learn.
What he's really known for too is the Nightmare Before Christmas.
Okay.
He did that.
But we don't identify that. We identify the Batman.
Yeah, we've never seen that movie before. None of us have ever seen it.
Me neither. That's what everyone always talks about him for, though.
Appreciate you doing that extra research, because I know it was research. Thank you, D-Lo. Thank you for that.
I remember it was like one movie everyone always used to talk about, and that's why I forgot it, because it was that movie.
Yep.
For sure, man.
So Danny Elfman, to answer your question, Amaya Zing.
Luda behind me is coming.
Goodness. So the movie started out, man. It started out all right, man. You know, you got the family, you know, they get mugged in the alley. And then, by the way, spoiler alert, if you ain't seen this movie in the 30 years it's been out, I can't do nothing for you.
Spoiler alert.
movie been out for 32 years.
That's a spoiled alert. Like,
really?
Old, you spoiled.
There's this thing, like, when the dudes that robbed the couple, they sitting there counting the money. And Batman in the background, he just decided to open his wingspan up so that nobody can see it. Nobody see it. But the camera, he decided to lift it. It's like somebody in the special effects department figured out how to do that right before the movie. And they're like, y'all about to get this shot.
Yep.
Y'all about to get this shot.
I was going to say, I was watching this very carefully and I rewinded these scenes because there were a couple of them. It's whenever he enters a scene, right? Like when he's Batman, he'll like fall down, but it's almost in slow motion.
Yep.
Like he's coming down like this. Mm. Like he has his arms out too. Like he's just floating. Like that.
Yeah. And funny that y'all made mention of the introduction, because one of the things that I noticed, just to piggyback on Chris's point, is out of all things that Batman was able to hear, being on that top, because remember, like you said, as the couple was getting robbed and everything, the robber said, don't yell out or don't scream. And what's the lady do? She screams out, and that's the only thing Batman heard. And it was like,
hold on. I got to say something, because that was actually more gangster than that. He said, for the sake of your son, don't scream. She was like, nah, kill him. That was hilarious. He said, for the sake of your son, don't scream. And she was like, yo, funny. Go ahead.
My man, Bruce Wayne was just chilling on his towel. Of all things he could have heard, gunshots. Could have heard some black people blasting the music. Heard an airplane fly by. My man, here's this one woman.
There was only one black person in here.
Go ahead.
There was only one black person in all of Gotham City, and it was Billy D. Williams.
That's all the black you need, brother.
That was also my second point.
That lady sings the blues, brother. Come on.
That was also my second point. Besides the dramatic entries, that was just amazing. Like you said, my man was gangster, throwing up the hands with the every time he entered the scene. And then when he would walk in the background like Jason, just creeping behind folks, he would always throw it. I remember.
And Michael, by the way, I'm sorry, he's not the only black person in Gotham. Michael Keaton is white, but Batman is black.
Agreed.
He's gonna say that and give himself back. What's wrong with
and, look. And apparently his best friend Harvey Dent is black too. We watching this movie, I was like, oh, that's Harvey Dent.
Yeah, which is crazy because they could have used Billy Dee for what, Batman Forever, and they didn't. But that's a whole nother load of trash to begin with. So let's backpedal back to the semi-good movie. So, like, Jack Nicholson did a fantastic job as the Joker. His acting was on point. But it's funny, man. Like, it was funny. Like, people kept saying, like, before he became the Joker, people kept calling him crazy, right? Like, he's crazy. And I guess that was the setup. Okay, well, he's already a little off. He's going to go to the Joker. But he didn't do nothing, like, outside of the criminal realm that would make that man just crazy. Like, he was doing regular bad guy criminal stuff, and then he fell into the bat, and now he's out of his mind. You know what I'm saying?
I don't think he laughed once in the movie before that.
Pretty much no laughter before that point. All of a sudden he's the Joker. He just happened to wear a purple suit on the night that he fell into chemicals. He had on regular color suits every other day. The night he fell into chemicals, let me burst out this purple John here.
He started wearing purple suits and listening to Prince, and then all this.
Yo,
I'm gonna kill him on this.
The art gallery scene was one of the freshest. That your boy. In the art gallery, running through the art gallery, messing up the artist
all day. But those speaking of a couple scenes, them jokes, man. Two things I want to touch on real quick. Them jokes, they did not age well at all. Like, there was some of them that was them things hit flat. What was it? My man said to Bruce Wayne, "Can I get a grant?" Like, it was like. What was that? Then of course, the robbers in the very beginning, he had American Express card. Don't leave home without it. Like,
Yo. Real talk though. Bruce Wayne's reply to "Can I get a grant?" though was fresh, because they were talking all types of smack because they didn't know he was there, and he played it straight cool. He was like, "All right, yeah. Get a couple more bottles of champagne. Alfred, get this man a grant. I'ma holler at you." It was just like, you were talking crap, but I'm so baller. I'm gonna go ahead and get you a grant anyway. And just walk off.
I think y'all missed one of the cringiest scenes, I think, was when they asked her why she was there, Vicky, and her response was, I wrote this down. I like bats. Oh no, you had to put that in there?
Cringy.
Oh goodness.
Cringy. Another cringy moment is, have you noticed in watching this, everyone that shoots the gun, they always stand still. Like, something about just standing completely still while you're firing it is the best way. You're not peeking through a corner, you're not shooting over something, none of that. It's simply,
I did appreciate how they explain how the Waynes got their fortune in this movie. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, Batman had stock in Amazon because he had the Amazon voice remote to operate his car. Shields on.
Yep.
Shields off.
Stop.
Had the Amazon voice remote to get the whip going.
Another thing I noticed, it was like the fight choreography was like, it's actually really good. I enjoyed it, But the thing was, like, when he stopped with the fight choreography, it felt like him just in his suit was like the most awkward movements you could possibly. It was just like
he was. Oh, yeah, he couldn't move his neck.
Yep. Not at all. Not at all. No neck movements. Whole body turns. Whole body turns.
Do you know? Do you know where that got shot out? That well, you know. Never mind. Go ahead. Go ahead.
I'm gonna add my opinion on this movie. Now I know this movie had a lot of cringy scenes. I don't remember line by line, and I hadn't seen it. I didn't watch it recently, but I've seen it plenty of times. Remember this movie, and I think it did stand, you know, the test of time for when it came out. This movie dropped in 1989, Batman with Michael Keaton. Now, before that, I remember when that movie came out. I mean, this movie received an enormous fanfare. I mean, they was making T-shirts. They was opening up rides at Six Flags. I mean, that's all
that, that Batman emblem, I think it's still the, like, the Batman emblem. Like, when you think of Batman, that's what you think of, the one they have from that movie.
Yeah. Right. That's they advertised that movie like I don't know what. Now, before this Batman came out, all we had, remember, I don't know if y'all remember the TV series.
Please with, talk about
Adam
this.
West.
Yes, no.
School them.
Pow. Bang.
We had that one and Super Friends Batman. It was just, now this made, now they had the comic books. I wasn't into the comic books like that. But when this Batman came out, we seen Batman in a whole new light. It wasn't no Robin. Batman was, he was the Dark Knight in 89. It was, Gotham City was dark. He was doing his thing. I mean, you know, it was not like we seen.
Never saw Batman time. Like, or Joker. No, Batman or Joker. You've never seen them like this. Joker was murdering people.
Yeah.
Right.
Batman was murdering people. I was going to.
For real.
Hold up. So he.
Yo,
so
you have a 35-inch tablet. I'm sorry. I'm not hating. Yeah, that's a 35-inch tablet.
So, yeah, you are.
Hold that joint up. Come on.
Wow. Got the notepad full of notes.
Hello? I'm with you. There it is.
Got a truck.
Where your notes at?
Oh, I was there. I'm good.
You were there.
Yes. I was going to say, so there's the scene at
I'm
the chemical
I'm literally holding
plant.
Back.
From my there's the scene at the chemical plant, right? Where he goes, drives the car in there. He drops bombs.
He don't even drive the car. And he don't even drive the car. He used the Alexa voice remote.
Yeah, he drops the bombs and the whole plant explodes.
One bomb, one little ball bomb, John. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the whole plant explodes. So it those was, people died.
It was almost like those it was, people. Yo, it was almost like Batman was like, yo, let me go ahead. Hold on. Let me get out of the car in case this doesn't go well. Yep. Alexa, send a car in there to drop a bomb. Straight Saddam Hussein the whole building.
Not to mention, he had ample amount of ammo. He was shooting down doors. He was blowing stuff up when he was taking down the balloons. He was shooting folks.
So can we talk about? I'm sorry. Can we talk about the second black dude in Gotham City that was pulverizing Batman at the end of the movie? Straight working him like a part-time job. Just
and he got the second gruesome death.
Oh yeah, the leg lock, the figure four leg lock.
Pulled off the thing.
I just appreciate so much the like lead villains, like the tough guy roles of like the dude with the swords, the dude at the end, like all those guys just came in 100%. They were ready to go.
But like, hey man, dude with the like swords jumped over a barbed wire fence.
Gangster, because he had the.
Let's talk about the fact that they were on top of a church that they did not know that Batman wasn't going to crash into. They were everywhere. Like, yeah. So if he crashes into this library, we'll be up.
We'll be up there.
If he crashes into the church, we'll be upstairs. Yeah, they were ready.
That man had on-call helicopter assistance. Get here in 5 minutes.
Hurry
make
up.
Make it 10 minutes.
On-call helicopter assistance, but only brought a rope ladder, and he don't look like he have the upper body strength to take on that rope ladder.
Yo, you know what's crazy? You know what's crazy, though? It's two things for me. Number one, when they were gangsters, before he became the Joker, everybody was wearing suits. And then after that, they had personalized starter jackets with Joker on them.
Yep.
and Joker was the only one allowed to wear the suit after that. Like the whole squad, he got them all starter jackets.
They was riding with him
with Joker on that joint.
That was team. That's squad.
That's number one.
That's henchman 101.
Henchman 101.
How did the police not catch that though?
Number two.
It was two scenes that I saw that I was like, where the police at? Like
really?
One
really?
Was at the chemical plant. What was it? Jack's sidekick rolled up on the commissioner at gunpoint.
Right.
Batman had him lifted up in the air. My man said, yo, put him down. Where he come from? Like, where he come from?
So check this out. That dude, he had his back the whole time, right? Remember in Axis Chemicals?
He had his back, but where'd he come from? My man just sent
Hold on. But let's talk about this, though. And FaZe can back me up on this. When the Joker, remember when they were doing the balloon, John?
Yep.
And then the Joker came down and was like, yo, where did he get that plane from? He's like, yo, give me a gun. And he gave him his gun. And he shot
that man.
The dude that held him down the whole movie.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm getting you.
Wasted.
Hold on, real quick. Stuff like that.
Fellas, before we get too deep, we gotta conclude this episode because our time is winding down. Now, if you do want to catch the remainder of this conversation, please tune in to our bonus episode. It will be available on our Patreon. That's patreon.com/influentent. Once again, that's patreon.com/influentent. I'm going to say it again because Cooley don't like when I spell. That's that's patreon.com/influentent. Everybody have a great time and good night.
The corner.